Did you know that your baby
you're here, and Merry Christmas in the middle of this season. Just wanted to run a few things by us in the way of announcements so that we're kind of mindful of what we're doing and what's going on, and then I'll get out of the way so that we can really get into some worship this morning. Tree of Hope gifts, we're collecting those gifts today, hopefully. We took 33 children that we, as a church family and some people connected with our church family, are helping to provide Christmas gifts for. So hopefully, if you got those here this morning, we're going to deliver those to the resource centers at those two schools tomorrow. And then they will get those distributed to those kids this week before school goes out. Play practice today at 4 o'clock for kids and at 4:30 for teens and adults. So if you're involved in the Christmas play, the Christmas program, if you can be here, please, so we can get through that and try to get everything honed and refined and sanded and crafted and ready for next Sunday night. We'll also practice on Friday and then keep Saturday kind of clear if possible in case we see a need to have another one. We'll see how that goes. Speaking of the Christmas program, that will be next Sunday night. So that's the 20th. Next Sunday night at 6 o'clock. It's three plays in one. So there's a kids' play, there's a teen play, and there's an adult play. And then we'll have some music and surprises along the way that night as we just celebrate the Lord's birth together. And then after that next Sunday night, if you could, bring in cookies. All you talented folk, I don't want to say ladies, I don't want to seem like men can't bake, but if you could bring in cookies that evening, we'll kind of share in just a cookie fellowship after the plays that they didn't have coffee, hot chocolate, hot cider, water, if it so pleases you, and cookies, and just have a time of fellowship that evening. That next Wednesday, not this coming Wednesday, but the next, that's the 23rd, that evening at 7 o'clock, we're going to have a special service. We're going to take communion that evening. So we're going to call it, I'm calling it the three C's, candles, carols, and communion. So we're going to light some candles, sing some Christmas carols, take communion together, and then I'll have a message that evening. And the title of the message for that evening is Born to Die. I said that to somebody, and I thought, well, that's kind of harsh. And I said, yeah, it was. But we're going to talk about the reason that Jesus came in and how he came to give his life for us, and then we'll take communion as we think about his sacrifice that evening. We're going to have a watch night service and fellowship on New Year's Eve here at the church. So we'll have some singing. I'll share a thought or two from God's Word, and then we'll have some fellowships, play some games, have some food and that kind of thing, and then we'll come back in here and pray the old year out and the new year in together as a church family that evening. Invite people. Christmas is one of those times that you can really get people into the church. And for better or for worse, let's just use that to our advantage. If it's a time that people's hearts are a little more tender or people are a little more receptive to invitations to come to church, then let's use that to our advantage. So invite somebody to come with you next Sunday morning for church or to the Christmas play or to the candles, carols, and communion service next Wednesday night. And let's pack the house and really just show people the gospel message and confront them with the gospel and see what people's lives be changed. Finally, this morning, as always, we take our offering. We don't pass an offering, but we have that basket back by the door that we collect our offering in. If you will notice, beside that basket, there is a red gift bag there, marked love offering. We're going to take a special love offering for a family this morning who has a need, a family of seven who doesn't have the means to provide Christmas. They don't know we're doing this. We're not telling who they are, but they have a need. And so if you'd like to give to that family to help them provide Christmas for a large family, then we just ask you to drop it in that red bag, and we will make sure that it gets to that family to help them provide Christmas in a time of need that they don't really have the answers for. Anything else that we need to share this morning? All right, let's stand. And I'll open us up in a word of prayer. We'll continue in some worship this morning. But Father, we're so thankful for the freedom that we have to be here, for the opportunity that we have to gather in your house, in your name, with your people. Father, as we talked about on Wednesday night, what worship truly means. Would you help us, Father, to worship you this evening in spirit, or this morning in spirit and in truth? Would you help us, Father, to forget about everything that lies beyond these four walls, everything that would distract us, everything that would occupy our minds? Father, would you just help us to cast those things out and to focus on you? Lord, as we sing these songs, would you help us to focus on who you are, and what you are, and what you've done to us, for us, what you've revealed to us about yourself. Father, as we look into your word this morning, would you speak to us in a fresh and a new way from your word this morning? Challenge us through the work of the Holy Spirit, Father, that we could draw closer to you, that we could take action that we need to take to become who you want us to be this morning, and that we could leave here this morning saying it was good to have been in the house of the Lord. Would you be with us in all that we do, Father? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I was thinking about this next song. It's a new one. And how the Bible says there's none good, no, not one. And our righteousness is as filthy rags. And we all fall short of the glory of God daily. But how His mercy is new every day for us. And His grace is sufficient for us. And how in the Bible it talks about they looked for the one that was worthy to open up the seals and they only found one. And how that one is so worthy of our praise and our worship this morning. Just listen to the words of this song. And think about what God's done for you and where He's brought you from.
Beautiful, and your hair.
minutes to go for their time. Here's a Miss Lucy. Well, good morning again. We're taking these few weeks around Christmas to try and almost kind of declutter our brains a little bit. Because I think for most of us in this day and age, when we hear the word Christmas, when the calendar starts to flip to December, or apparently like October in our day and age, but when the time starts to become upon us, our brain starts to just kind of fizzle a little bit and chatter and buzz, and we start to think about songs, and we start to think about traditions and memories and smells and obligations and gifts we need to buy and places we need to go and dinners we need to cook. And we start to think about all these expectations and plans and things. And not that any of that is bad, but it can be distracting. And so for these 3 weeks, last Sunday, today, and then next week, we're trying to rewind the clock a little bit and put ourselves in the shoes of people who had never heard the word Christmas, who had never seen or heard the name Jesus, and were asking the question, when they heard this news, how did it affect them, and what does that mean for us? And so last week we looked at Joseph, and we tried to get in the mind, get in the shoes of Joseph a little bit and see what it would have been like for him and how he responded to the call that God gave him. And so today we're going to do the same thing. We're going to put ourselves in the shoes of Mary a little bit. And I always feel like we almost need to do a little extra decluttering when it comes to Mary. Because there are so many traditions connected to her. And I think the danger with Mary in our world is that people go like to one extreme or the other. I mean, on one extreme, some people go and make Mary into something that she was never meant to be. Make Mary into something almost as an idol to be worshipped, something to be prayed to, and try to put her almost on the same status or the same pedestal with Jesus. And not only is that really against what we read and what the Bible teaches, but Mary would have been against that, because I believe that when you look at the life of Mary, everything in her life, everything that we read about Mary, actually pointed back to Jesus. The other extreme, some people put her on a pedestal and like elevate Mary into this almost godlike status. The other extreme is that we just downplay Mary so much that we almost basically ignore her. Because sometimes we non-Catholics feel a little bit threatened by Mary. Like, you want to be able to hear about Mary? Maybe you should ask the priest about that. And we don't talk about her maybe as often or as deeply as we should. But do you realize this morning that we know more about Mary than we know about just about any other person in the New Testament except for Jesus, Peter, Paul, and John? So Jesus, Peter, Paul, and John, we know more about. Fifth in the New Testament of people that we know information and details about is Mary. And think about it. We know her husband was Joseph. We know that her relatives were Zechariah and her cousin Elizabeth. We know, if you read in Luke's Gospel, we know a song that she sang during this Christmas story called the Magnificat. We know that when she was pregnant, she traveled from Galilee to the hill country to visit Elizabeth. And then she travels from Galilee to Bethlehem to give birth. We know that she and Joseph dedicated the baby, or the boy Jesus, the baby boy Jesus in the temple. We know she visited the temple with Jesus when she was 12 years old. We know she went to a wedding in Cana with Jesus and saw his first miracle after he had grown up. We know she was at the crucifixion of Jesus. We know she was one of the first Christians in Jerusalem, if you flip over into Acts chapter 1. And we know that another one of her sons, James, becomes this leader in the early church. So really, when we talk about Mary, it's more than just the Christmas story. When we talk about Mary, we're talking about a major character in the Scriptures. And for some reason, and we'll talk about it this morning, Mary is the one person in history who's chosen to give birth to the Messiah. She's chosen to give birth to Jesus. So if we ignore Mary, then we're really missing out on some major stuff. So we're not going to idolize her, but we're also not going to ignore her. So let's give Mary the attention that she deserves this morning and look at the example, the Christian example that she gives us. So we're going to look in Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. And Mary said to the angel, how will this be, since I'm a virgin? And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren, for nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. When I read this passage, when I read the way that Luke, the physician, recounts this and tells the story, Mary strikes me as so human. Because she doesn't get it at first. She struggles with it. She even challenges it just a little bit. Just like us. Just like we do so many times when we hear the grace of God, when we hear the gospel of God, or when God calls us to something, we kind of think it's a little sketchy, we kind of don't want to believe it, we kind of question it a little bit. But then as Mary goes through this process of struggling and questioning and challenging, eventually something amazing happens for Mary. And so as this conversation unfolds, as we look back through these verses that we just read from Luke's gospel, I see three things as we look through this that Mary has to respond to that we're going to look at this morning. First of all, how does she respond to God's grace? How does Mary respond to God's grace? Because the concept of grace, if we're going to know any concept, any term from the Bible, the concept of grace is incredibly important. And we see the angel use that word when he talks to Mary, when he speaks, when he gives Mary this call or this challenge. And when we think about grace, the grace comes from the Greek word charis, which can be translated as grace or favor or gift. So always grace means something that was given, something not, I should say earned, not earned. Grace is always something that is earned, not something that's deserved. It's a gift. And in the next couple of weeks, most all of us are going to be handed something at some point in the next couple of weeks. Something wrapped up, maybe with a bow on top. And here's what we will not say when somebody gives us that, wrapped up in paper with a bow on it. When they hand that to us, we will not say, well, what do I owe you for that? Do you take checks or do you take cash? Because when it's a gift, all you have to do is what?
Receive it.
All you have to do is receive it, hopefully, say thank you. And this encounter, that's what Mary has with the angel. She begins to see that God is extending grace to her. In verse 26, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth. And we're so used to hearing Jesus of Nazareth that I think to us, if we speak churchese, that Nazareth is almost like this famous place to us. But Nazareth was not a famous place. Nazareth was off the beaten path. Like, you didn't just stumble into Nazareth. If you went to Nazareth, you did it intentionally. It was kind of obscure. And up to this point in the Gospel of Luke, I mean, we're only 20 verses or so in, but up to this point in the Gospel of Luke, most of the action has taken place in Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is the hub. Jerusalem is the big city. That's where the action takes place. That's where the leaders are. That's where the rich and the powerful and the elite are. And then all of a sudden the story shifts and it's like, meanwhile, out in Nazareth. So this would be like the main story takes place in Louisville or Lexington. That's where the money is. That's where the big buildings are. That's where the big banks are. That's where the stuff is. The big story is taking place in Louisville or Lexington. And then it says, meanwhile, in Neon. Y'all laugh, but Nazareth was that obscure up until they had a really famous citizen named Jesus. So Mary didn't get this assignment. Mary doesn't get chosen to be the earthly mother of God because she was from an influential city. And then in verse 27, it says, the angel came to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And we talked a little bit last week about, when we talked about Joseph, about what it meant to be betrothed. And that it's so much more than what we think of as engaged, because it was already a contractual agreement that you didn't get out of without a divorce. And it was common for a girl to get betrothed, to get into this agreement that's really more serious than marriage, right after puberty. So Mary was probably somewhere between 13 and 15 years old. And she's betrothed to this guy named Joe. We'll call him Joe this morning. We'll shorten down Joseph. So she's engaged to this guy named Joe, who's this good guy, this honest, hardworking guy. Certainly, he's nobody out of the ordinary. He's not studying to be a rabbi. He didn't make the cut for that. He's a blue-collar worker. So really, he's like Joe the carpenter from a town like Neon, so to speak. And of course, we don't know what Mary looked like. And as a history person, I like to think about it this way. There's so much history of art, of what, where people tried to draw or paint what Mary looked like. And they probably got it wrong. And so as we look at some different pieces that I just pulled off of the Google, so we can kind of see the way that the world tends to think about Mary. Here's a piece from Philippe de Champagne from the early 1600s called The Annunciation. Beautiful painting. But I'm not sure he really captured the youthfulness of Mary as a 13 to 15-year-old girl, maybe the way that he could have. Here's another one from Matisse. Same time period, and again, Mary looks a little bit older than she probably was. Here's one from Henry Tanner. This is done in 1898, and that one might be a little more realistic. A little bit younger girl, looking a little more shocked, looking a little more normal than being portrayed in all these elaborate garments and with light like over her. A little more realistic situation for the girl from a town like Neon, being surprised by it. And then there's this actress who played Mary in the movie The Nativity Story, which is a pretty good portrayal. And I think they did a good job there of portraying Mary as a normal girl, a really young girl, youthful, young, simple, from a common town. And they kind of capture the kind of town that she lived in. So this angel has come to Mary, who's this young, plain, common girl from a little podunk town in the Middle East. And then in verse 28, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." The Latin word for greetings is Ave. And that's where that phrase Ave Maria comes from. That suits some people's fancy. I came on my Pandora Christmas station the other day and I gave it a thumbs down. Not really into the whole opera scene, but if you're into that, that's where Ave Maria comes from. That's greetings to Mary. And the old English word for greetings is hail. And that's where the phrase Hail Mary comes from. And I'm sure there are a few guys sitting here this morning thinking, you mean that's not a football term? But that's where those terms that we don't necessarily use, but that's where they come from. It's a reference to the greetings that the angel gave Mary in this instance. So you say, okay, maybe the word greetings doesn't really make Mary anything special. But what about the next line? Oh, favored one. Greetings, yeah, but then he says to Mary, and he calls her the favored one, or in some translations of the Bible, you who are blessed and highly favored. And we would say, doesn't that show that Mary had some kind of special status? Yes and no. Yes, Mary did have a special role to play in this Christmas story, in the birth of Jesus. But here's the thing, Mary didn't earn that role. Mary didn't earn that role because the word there that was translated as favored comes from the same word as grace, charis, that we talked about earlier. It's the same word as gift. So God didn't look around from heaven and try to find the holiest person, the holiest young female on earth and say, okay, Mary wins. She gets the job. God chose Mary out of pure grace. This whole thing, this whole choosing her to be Jesus' mother was God's gift to her. And so in verse 29, Mary gives her response to being chosen for this thing. And verse 29 tells us, but she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what kind of greeting this might be. So if I had to summarize what Mary's response would be, I would give you a really deep theological term for Mary's response to what's going on so far. Huh? That's basically where Mary is at this point in the story. Mary responds to God's grace, and she says, huh? Because that's basically what she's thinking, right? Like, what is this? She's troubled. She's confused. She doesn't quite get it. And you know what? That's actually a pretty honest, pretty good response to God's grace. Because you want to know how you can tell that somebody has never really received the gospel, has never really received God's grace? When people say things like, I've been a Christian all my life. I've always believed in Jesus and God and all that. I'm a good person, you know. I live a good Christian life. You know what that means? That person has never really been amazed by grace. Because when you really encounter God's grace, when you really begin to understand what it means for you, here's what you can say. You can say, and I'm paraphrasing, but here's you can say what Mary said in this instance. Huh? You can say just like Mary, huh? I can't believe that God would accept me. But that's insane. Me, with all the stupid things I do, with all my selfishness, with all my anger, with all my doubt. Me? And we sing songs. And so many times I think that we get in the church into the habit of just singing lines of songs, and we don't sometimes stop to think what they mean. We sang this song on Wednesday night that said, amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? That's when we begin to understand what grace really was. That the King of glory, that the perfect Son of God came and He died so He could take my sins and let me be forgiven from Him so I could have eternal life. Or the classic hymn, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a basically good guy like me. No, a wretch like me. So Mary's initial response when she hears God's grace and receives God's grace and begins to understand it was pretty spot on. Because Mary starts to realize that she's out of her league. Mary starts to realize that she's out of her league, just like we all should, when God begins to pour out His grace on us. And this Christmas, I wonder if we need to ask God to just kind of jolt us with that. God, could you wake me up? Could you help me to understand again what you did for me? What grace really means on my life? Would you just hit me over the head with what this thing really means? And so while we're singing the Christmas carols and while we're accepting communion a couple of Wednesday nights from now, would we just allow ourselves to be unsettled, to be made uncomfortable by understanding what His grace is, what He gave us when He came to the manger, and that He came to the manger so that He could go to the cross. So Mary responds to God's grace and she says, huh? Now let's see how Mary responds to God's plan. God's plan for her. Look at verses 30 through 33. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. I like this quote from a guy named Glenn Evans, who said this. He said, God must reserve for himself the right of the initiative, the right to break into my life without question or explanation. That shattering phone call, that disturbing letter, may indeed be the first stage of God's interruption in my life. And since God does the initiating, he must be responsible for the consequences. You see, God has broken into Mary's life in a dramatic way. He can do that. Again, thinking about last week, what we talked about, how Jewish culture would have been, Mary is in this agreement with Joseph. They're in this betrothal, which is basically like a pre-marriage. They're basically married without the ring and the benefits at this point. So Mary and Joseph are in this betrothal relationship, and then an angel shows up and says, hey Mary, guess what? You're pregnant. And in her society, Mary, in the back of her mind, knows what this is going to mean for her. Mary knows how people are going to look at her, what they're going to say about her, what they're going to think about her. So God has really intervened and changed Mary's life in a dramatic way. And so Mary asks this really practical question in verse 34. And Mary said to the angel, how can this be? How will this be since I'm a virgin? Here's how I would respond, here's how I would summarize Mary's response to this question of God's plan. God reveals his plan, and Mary's response is, how? And God has told her through the angel what the plan is, and Mary's response is how? Like, God, I hear you calling to me to this, but I don't see how it's possible. How is this thing going to happen? Can you relate to Mary at all in that way? It might seem like a strange question because, again, Mary's calling is kind of unique. But think about this. When you're really following the living God, when you're really being led by the Holy Spirit of God, He's going to call you to do things that are too big for you.
Amen.
He's going to call you to step out of the boat and onto the water in situations that you will fail unless He's there for you.
Amen.
He's going to call you into those situations. That's when He calls us to the impossible. And that's where we in our flesh can respond like Mary and say, but God, how? And I think back on conversations that I've had with people. The guy who thought the whole cancer thing was over and now it's back and he can't believe that he has to go through this again. And like Mary, he thinks, God, how can this be? How can I possibly handle this again? The young single woman who thought that unemployment was behind her and now she's lost her job again and she says, God, how can this be? I believe you've put me here, but I just don't know how I'm going to do it. Or the college guy who's so fired up about Jesus and he knows God is calling him to ministry. And the thought of doing anything else besides that is so unsatisfying to him, but he knows his family doesn't approve. And he has no idea how he'll make enough money to survive. And he asks, like Mary did, how will this be? It seems, and I've seen this in my life in the past couple of years, it seems like God just loves to do that. He loves to intrude in our lives, and he loves to draw us out of our comfort zones. And can I just tell you, he loves to do that, or he would love to do that with churches too. As we plan, as we think as a church for the next year and the future, if everything that we say that we're going to do, if everything that we plan seems perfectly normal and average and practical and doable, if everything we do as a Christian, if everything we do as a church can be done in our own power, we're not in the center of God's plan. Because He wants to draw us out of that into something bigger, into something so big, into something so life-changing, into something so hell-shattering that it will fail if He's not in it. That's the kind of thing that He wants to call us to. Does that make sense? Because if it's from God, you should be saying, God, how will this be? It seems a little bit crazy. It seems a little bit ambitious. I believe that that's exactly where God wants us to be as people, as individual Christians, and as a church. God, how are we going to do that? So Mary encountered God's grace, and she realized that God had chosen her to do this, and she said, huh? And then she encounters God's plan, and then God reveals to her through the angel what exactly she is supposed to do, and she says, how in the world is this going to happen? And here's the final thing that Mary encounters, and that is God's power. So here's the answer to the how question in verse 35. And the angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. In other words, Mary asks that question, how? And the angel looks at her and says, Mary, this is going to be a totally supernatural thing. You don't have to try really hard to pull this off in your own power and figure out how to make this happen. All you have to do is yield yourself and allow God to do this in a supernatural way. Offer yourself to Him. Yield yourself. Sacrifice yourself to Him and let Him work through you.
Amen.
Richard Stearns, who's the president of World Vision that does a lot of great work around the world for children and for orphans, said this a while back. He said, God's plan for us does not rely on our greatness, but on His. Whatever you face, He will see you through. And I would say this to us this morning. If God has placed you in some kind of tough situation and you're wondering how it's even possible to get out of this thing, here's what it is. It's not by trying really, really hard. It's not by gritting your teeth and saying, man, I know I can do this. It's by admitting your inability and turning to God in your neediness, in your desperation, in your helplessness, and saying, God, you've got to do this because I can't.
Amen.
When we get to that point of surrender where we can say, God, you got to do this because I can't. God, you got to fix this because I can't. God, you got to use this because I can't. When we get to that point of yielding, of surrender, it's that point that He can move. Remember what Jesus said. He said, apart from me, you can do nothing. But if you abide in me, if you yield yourself to me, you will produce much fruit. You see, the character and the power of Christ will be produced through our life, and we can conceive and we can give birth. And that kind of makes us uncomfortable to say it that way. But in the same way that Mary, through the Holy Spirit of God, was able to conceive and give birth to great things through the power of God, we can conceive and give birth to great things through the power of God when we yield and when we surrender in the way that Mary did. So Mary is struggling with this whole thing. And the angel says, Mary, if you're having a hard time believing this, look, verses 36 and 37. Like, Mary, as if I hadn't given you enough that it was hard to believe. In verse 36 and 37, and behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren, for nothing will be impossible with God. Because Mary's still at this point of, God, how's this thing going to happen? And just because he can, the angel tells us about what God had done, and he says, well, guess what? Your cousin Elizabeth, who's really, really old, who was called barren, who wasn't supposed to be able to have children, guess what? Nobody thought she could have a baby either, and she's already 6 months along. And then he gives us that verse. He gives Mary this verse that we can cling to in a situation like this. For nothing will be impossible with God.
Amen.
I wonder if we really stand on that this morning. I wonder if we really stand on those seven words this morning when we face the situations that we face in our life. In marital problems, in financial problems, in work problems, in all of the issues that we face on this earth. I wonder if we stand on those seven words or if we say, this is impossible. There's no answer to this. There's no way out here. Yeah, there's not, as long as we're doing it in our own power. There's not, as long as we're looking in our flesh and on our own for the answers. But again, when we can get to that point where we say, God, you've got to do this because I can't. God, you've got to fix this because I can't. When we get to that point of yielding, then nothing really is impossible without God or with God. As for Mary, it seemed like for Elizabeth, it was too late to have a baby. And for Mary, she thinks, man, it's too soon. It's too early to have a baby. But both of those things are happening, the angel tells her, because nothing is impossible with God. Or I love the way that it's worded in some other translations of the Bible, where it says, no word from God will ever fail.
Amen.
And we see this throughout the Scriptures. Take, for example, the miracle of Lazarus being raised from the dead. Because the whole idea with Lazarus, the whole idea, the whole reason that we have that story 2,000 years later to read about is we need to understand that when things seem hopeless, there is still hope. When things seem hopeless, there is still hope because of the power of Christ. I was reading this week about a pastor who preached on the story of Lazarus. And that same week, there was a woman from his church who took her daughter in for a biopsy. And this woman is completely stressed out. The daughter had a medical history. The daughter had had some problems. She's stressed out. She's worried about her future. She's worried about her kids. She's worried about treatment that they could have to face. And on the drive over, the mom had just heard this sermon on Lazarus. So she's telling her daughter about Lazarus, about how Jesus shows up in our dark places. And then they go to the doctor's office. They get called back. They go to the room. It was a big clinic with multiple doctors. And the doctor walks in, I kid you not, and says, hello, I'm Dr. Lazarus. And she said, we just looked at each other, and we knew that God was in that, and that he was going to get us through it, because nothing is impossible with God. And it's awesome to see how Mary finally responds to this call of God on her life. Because she's had some questions. She gets confronted with God's grace and realizes that it's her that's been chosen. And she says, huh? And she finds out that she's going to have this immaculate conception. She's going to become pregnant by the Holy Spirit and give birth to the Son of God. And she says, how? But then, when the angel begins to confront her with God's power, when the angel begins to explain to her that it is the power of the Holy Spirit that's going to do this, that her cousin Elizabeth is already 6 months pregnant because of what God has done in her, when Mary begins to be confronted with God's power, look at verse 38. And Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Mary answered, may it be to me as you have said. And then the angel left her. And I would summarize Mary's response like this. She said, huh, when she heard about God's grace. And she said, how, when she heard about God's plan. But when she heard about God's power, you know what she said? Yes.
Amen.
You see, we too many times get stuck after the second question. And we hear about God's grace, that God has chosen me, that God can take my filthy rags. Y'all know what that really refers to when it talks about filthy rags in the Bible? I'm not saying this to be graphic, and I'm not saying this to be crude and rude, but the literal translation, if you go back in that verse when it says filthy rags, is used menstrual garments. Essentially used tampons. In other words, our best, our righteousness, what we try to offer to the Lord in our own power, and what we do, is basically a used tampon in the Lord's eyes. It's okay. We can't do this thing on our own. And Mary begins to realize that. And the angel leaves her, and Mary says yes, and it's a yes of obedience. But too many times, I believe we get stuck after the first two questions. God's grace comes to us. We realize that God has chosen us, and we say, how could God use me? How could God use somebody like me? I've done too much. I've gone too far. I've gone too many places. I've seen too many things. And we get meld in there. And then we find out that God has a plan for our lives, that He has a way of salvation that He wants to offer to us. And we're too busy saying how. God's got a plan. God's got a calling. God's got a purpose for us. And we're too busy asking how. And too many times we get stuck right there. But if we would just encounter the power of God, if we would just encounter the power of the Holy Spirit in that moment, then our answer could be yes.
Amen.
I'm reminded of that old chorus of the church that said, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. And if we would actually live that, we'd shake the gates of hell. But too many times, we get caught up in those first two questions. Those first two questions are normal. That was a natural response for Mary to say, huh? God chose me. How is God going to do this? But you know what? As soon as the angel confronted her with God's power, as soon as the angel showed her the power of God and let her realize that God had the power, that the Holy Spirit was going to do this, Mary said yes. And I wonder this morning what we need to say yes to. I want us to watch a video clip before I wrap up this morning. This again is from the skit guys. Just from the perspective of Mary, helping us to think about what it would have been like for her to get into the shoes of Mary.
As long as I can remember, we'd been waiting for the Messiah to come for us. My family, our tribe, our whole nation. I always knew that he'd come, but... well, let's be honest. It's not like I'm from Jerusalem or someplace special. I'm just a girl. From Nazareth. And everybody knows that not much good comes from Nazareth. Never has. That angel had come to the wrong house with his announcement. But if that's what God wanted, well, who was I to tell him he was wrong? And Joseph, well, God bless that wonderful man. He could have joined in with everybody else. He could have had me sent away. He could have even had me killed. But he just never broke the promise to marry me. And so when he had to go to Bethlehem for the census, I was honored to ride by his side. Even with heartburn and bloated cankles and 9 months of pregnancy behind me. You know those women who try different things to induce labor, like going on frequent walks or eating spicy foods? What they should do is go on a bumpy 70-mile trip to Bethlehem. Because not long after I got there, and I'd never done this myself, but even I knew it was time. And with every wave of pain, I tried to ignore the fact that my family wouldn't be there to help me. And that I'd be bringing this baby into the world without the familiarity of home. But when Jesus finally came, I forgot all of that, though. I just wrapped him in cloths and tried to make the most comfortable bed I could for him with the only thing I had, which was an animal's feeding trough. Joseph Joseph said I should have been sleeping then, but I couldn't stop staring at him. There he was. The one the angel had told me about. My heart was so full, I couldn't even find words big enough to express it. I know I'm not the first young mother to bring a child into this world. It's always been that way. But as I look down at my son, my Redeemer, I knew that he would change everything because he'd already changed me.
See, Mary had a call in her life. God had a plan for Mary. God extended grace and extended a plan to Mary. And the long and the short of it was that Mary said yes. And because Mary said yes, the rest of human history was changed. Because Mary said yes and yielded to God's plan, God used her as a willing vessel to change the course of human history. Mary had a big yes. Here's the question I have for you this morning. There's so many of you this morning that have a call, that have a plan on your life this morning. That God is extending something to you this morning. That God has called you to something. For some of you this morning, it is to finally give in and let Him save you from your sins. That you have heard so many times that God has extended grace to you and you've been caught up in the, me? You've heard so many times that God has a plan for your life and God has a plan to save you, and your question has been how, and you stopped after those first two questions, and this is the morning that you've been confronted with the power of God and that God is asking you to say yes to what He wants to do in your life. And there are others of you this morning who God is calling to something. God is calling to a ministry. God is calling to a work. God is calling you to do something, to get outside your comfort zone and step out in faith in a way that if He doesn't come through, you're going to fail. And you've gotten caught up in those first two questions. And this is the morning that you get confronted with the power of God and you say, yes. There are some of you this morning who've been saved, but you're holding on to a lot of stuff in your life. You're holding on to a lot of stuff and you're not living a life of holiness because you're too concerned with the stuff that you can't let go of. And God has told you He has the grace to do it. God has told you He has a plan for your life to do it. And you're getting caught up in the and the how. And this is the morning that you lay down whatever it is. You lay down the addiction, you lay down the relationship, you lay down the attitude, you lay down the anger, and you give full surrender to Jesus Christ, and you're confronted with the power of God, and He begins to work and move in your life because you are finally a fully yielded vessel. I believe this morning that you know what the question is. You know what the call is. You know what your response to be. So I wonder this morning, what is it for you? What is it that God is calling you to? What is it, God, that God is asking of you that you've held back about saying yes on? And could this be the morning that you come and you fall on your knees and you say, yes, Lord. May it be to your servant, as you have said, that like Mary, you finally realize that you're never going to understand it all, that you're never going to be able to explain it all, but He wants to do something in you, and if you will just say yes and yield to Him, He will begin to do it. This is the morning that that can happen. But our Lord is a gentleman. He's given us free will. He will never beat down the door of our hearts. He will never barge in and make us do anything. He's asking for us to come and to yield to Him. And the question is this morning, will you come and will you yield to what He's calling you to? Could we stand this morning? The Bible tells us that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And I believe that in this place, this morning, there is the Spirit of the Lord. So I believe this morning that there is freedom to be found in this place. Different kinds of freedom for different place. Chains that He wants to break in this place this morning. And I've done the best that I can do in my old earthly self to explain it to you and try to get it to you. Here's the point. The Holy Spirit of God is speaking to hearts. The Holy Spirit of God is moving. The Holy Spirit of God is challenging people this morning. And now, the action's in the ball's in our court. Are we going to say yes? Are we going to stand back in question and say, and how, and hem-haw around? Or are we finally going to say yes to what He wants to do in our lives and give over to the power of God and let Him begin to move and work and use us? So if you need to pray this morning, would you come and pray? See, this is just a place of prayer. And we're not here to sit and think about it, wonder what they're praying about. This is a time for us to examine ourselves. So don't you worry about what anybody else in this room is thinking. Because if that's what they're thinking, they got their own problems.
Amen.
You do what God is calling you to do. You do what you need to do. You be honest and open with the Lord and say yes to Him this morning. And you let everybody else worry about themselves. Could we have a time of honest prayer? A time of honestly yielding to Him and saying yes to what He's calling us to this morning. While the waters are troubled, while the Spirit is moving. Will you say yes this morning?
Lift your eyes to heaven.
there's freedom to be found in that instant when we say yes. In that instant, in that moment when we yield, there is freedom to be found. There is grace to be found. There is forgiveness to be found. There is purpose to be found in that moment when we begin to yield and He can rush in to us and begin the work that He wants to do with us. And I believe this morning that freedom has been found. I believe and I know that this morning that yeses have been said in this place this morning, that just like Mary finally just said yes when she realized God had the power to do what she couldn't explain and what she couldn't understand, she said yes and God did it. And I know there are people this morning who said yes, but I also know this morning there are more people who need to say yes. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, every head bowed and every eye closed, no one looking around but me, me and you, I wonder this morning if there'd be somebody who would say, I know I need to say yes, and I haven't said it. If that's you, would you just slip your hand up? Nobody's looking around but me. It just gives me an indication of how to pray for you. I know I need to say yes, and I haven't. But you know. God bless you. Anybody else? Folks, we have no promise of tomorrow. We have no promise of another opportunity. And every day and every instant that we delay saying yes, is time we're missing out on that He wants to use us. It's time we're missing out on what He wants to accomplish through us, through His power and through His glory. So would you say yes to what He wants to do in your life? Mary said yes, and the world was forever changed. Let's pray before we go home. Father God, I thank You for this time of worship that we have had together this morning, for this time in Your Word that we've had together this morning. Father, I thank You most for the time that we have had in Your presence this morning together, Father. Father, I thank You this morning for the chains that were broken in this place because people said yes, not because of them, but because of what You were allowed and free to do in them in that moment that they yielded and they said yes. Father, to those who are still holding on, Father, to those who are still holding on to questions, huh, and how, and wondering, Father, would You confront them with Your power? Would You show them Your power the way that You showed Mary so that they could say yes? So that You could begin to move and work in them the way that You want to? Father, would You help us to be a people of yes? A people of yielding? A people of surrender? Because Father, if we could do that as individuals, if we could come together in one accord as a church body of people who say yes, oh Father, You could use us. You would use us. You would shake the foundations of this community. You would change hearts and lives and homes and communities, and You would shake the very gates of hell if we would get on board with that and get in one accord with it. Father, would You help us to realize that and help us to get on board with what You want to do in us and through us as individuals and as a church. Would You go with us and bless us and keep us as we leave this place this morning? Help us to be mindful of what You've shown us this morning, and help us, Father, to live it out in the week to come, not through our power, but through the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through us. For all that You've done, for all that You're doing, and for all that You're going to do in our future, we give You the glory and the honor and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.